Hi, I'm Boris and welcome to the Guide of Easy Painting. So last time I said that we would have a seascape, so my two seascapes I've already got. I had trouble, I've lost one, and the other one, I don't know, I've got trouble to get it on this channel. So what I'm going to do next is to paint a seascape, film it, and show it to you another time. In the meantime, we are going to see a landscape, and it will be about tonalism. So let me know at the end of the video what you thought. Leave some comments. If you can, or if you liked it, leave me a thumbs up and subscribe if that's not already done. Sit back, enjoy the video. So we are going to talk a bit about tonalism, but first of all, let me explain what I'm doing here. I'm toning my canvas with a blue-purple tint made out of ultramarine and alizarin crimson. And then I wipe off the excess, and on top of this, I will do my drawing out of ultramarine blue. So what is tonalism? It was an artistic style that emerged in the 1880s when American artists began to paint landscape. It forms with an overall tone of colored atmosphere of mist. That style didn't last very long. So it started about in the 1880s and found its end in 1915. Of course, all through the times afterwards, some were carrying on to do tonalism, but it wasn't a big movement anymore. So they used often dark, natural hues such as grey, brown or blue, often dominated compositions by artists associated with the style. So during the late 1890s, American art critics began to use the term tonal to describe those works. So we know two of those leading artists in tonalism, and there were George Innes and James McNeill Whistler. So if you want to check them out. But yeah, basically that's what it is. We get a hue. Here, for example, we've got blue, and then we stay in that value. So it doesn't mean, tonalism doesn't mean that we can not put any colours on, but we have to pick a value, for example, on a scale on 1 to 10. So often we say it's darker, so you would pick maybe a 7 on 8, leaving a bit of room for the dark darks and the light value. So light we would go up to 6 and dark then up to 10. But so it wouldn't mean we wouldn't use any color, but we would stay in a very short range of value and trying to keep together with a certain hue. So now my drawing is finished. I start to put the darks on and the lights, and then on top of this we are going to put some paint. My brush I'm using there is a filbert number 6.
Use a cotton pad to wipe off the sky holes. Also maybe put in some trunks and twigs and branches. You can use a brush if you prefer. So I borrowed this from an artist who has put a whole lesson on this. So I've of course shortened it to a max, well, because of copyrights, and I didn't want to stop the artist from selling her course. So, but her course is very long and is much more into it than this. That is only a general view on what tonalism is. But anyway, I'll put description in the link below if you're interested to check them out. So you spend as much time as you want at this stage, but I recommend to spend all the time you need to start with a good drawing, an accurate drawing. So now on my palette that we can't see, I put some piles of paint with different colors. You see I've got browns and I've got purples there, light browns and purples. But although they're two different colors, they are the same value. And that is what's very important, to find your range of value and keep that value all along the painting. So we do random strokes. Everything in the front goes vertically, everything in the middle ground goes horizontally, and everything in the top goes vertically again. Vertically again. And this adds to the depth of the painting. So you often will see me put horizontal strokes in the midground, vertical strokes in the foreground and in the skies as well. In the skies is often a mixture actually, but mostly vertical. So there in the trees, we put some purples as well, because the purples is a complement of the green and it will make those greens pop up very nicely. And often when the paint is wet, you can't see those subtle shifts. Now, if you look in the mid-ground there, what I just did, it looks all the same. But once the paint dries a little bit, you can see the purples and the browns and the yellows coming out. But it looks like that because it's all the same value. So this value, mid-ground value, was a value 6. I decided to go on a value 6. And there I jumped two values, so we're on the value 8. And in the sky and the water, I'm going to go and jump down two values. And from 6, we're going to be on the value 4. So for those who struggle with values, well, there's plenty of videos about it, but if you're interested, leave me a comment and we are going to do a course about values. I've got already some stuff which I can dub for you in values, but let me know if you're interested. It's very interesting and very important to grasp the notion of value in painting, because it's that very notion who gives you the depth, the form, it makes your picture look right. So it's very, very important to master the values. So putting in the darks, it's a green, olive green, what I made up there. So again, my greens are made up out of ultramarine blue, a cadmium yellow for the brightest one, but for the darkest one I use yellow ochre, and sometimes I use Indian yellow. I think that here was a combination of all three, Indian yellow and yellow ochre with ultramarine blue. So I tend to mix my colors. I'm not buying any greens out of the tube. Well, I've got, saying that, I've got a couple, and sometimes it's handy to have it, especially if you do a big picture. But in general, I make my greens, I make my blacks, my purples, etc. And I've got a limited palette. Again, if you're interested, I've got a video where I explain my palette. If you're interested, let a comment down below, and we are going to show this video on this channel then. It's not a long video, it's only a video about, I don't know, 10-15 minutes, but it just shows my palette and how I use the paint, how I mix the paint, and in a very easy way. So here, I'm on the value 6 again, and I know it doesn't look like it, but it is. Maybe it's a 5, but I think I'm going to darken it to a 6, if I remember well. I mean, yeah, 5, yeah, 5. Yeah, it's between a 5 and a 6. But yeah, I'm definitely going to darken it a bit, I think, because I realize it's a bit too light in value. So also let me know if you like that sort of videos, which are a bit fast forwarded, or if you'd like to have longer tutorial, as I said, usually they last more than an hour, but not everyone wants to sit through a tutorial for that long. Often these little tricks and tips are enough for you to do a painting. So there we're back in the value 6. And notice how the green goes nicely with those purple tint. So purple for mud and for underpainting for trees is a very nice color. So now we do the far bank, and again this is a 6. So for those who know how to see value, well, you know how to check this out. Then for the others, you need to squint so to block the light and to see less details and see more value. So the colors come together and you see more values. Well, you see more, the values are easier to spot, if you like. So there my sky should be a value 4. So we are in close range between the values. Oh, a slight light change, so it changes the whole picture. But yeah, notice how all the values are similar. Nothing is really jumping out. The sky is just one value lighter than the hills. The trees are the same values at the bank in the front. The greens of the bushes are the same value as well as the trees and the bank. So when you squint, everything is mushing together because they're all so very close. And that is what tonalism is, to pick one tone, stick with that tone, and stick with a very close value. Also, don't cover all the blue of the underpainting, because it does make it look a bit vibrant. It's quite nice if the blue comes through. So doing the water, we go back to a value 4. We have a value 4 there in the far ground, and we go to a value 5 in the front. Because remember that you need to have a degradation that it gradually needs to get darker going to the front, or lighter if you start from the front and go to the back. But as you see, it goes darker and darker as I come to the foreground, and this helps the picture not to be flat. If I would paint all this one value, it looked very flat. But because I'm degradation, I go darker and darker as I go to the front, it just goes to a plan and shows the distance very nicely. So remember that when you do a painting. Always need to be darker in the front and go lighter as you go in the back, so your picture doesn't seem flat. If you learned anything today, maybe that's the highlight. Although that's not the lesson of today, it's about tonalism. So you see how everything comes together? Nothing is too strong. So these pictures or paintings are very moody, you know, very misty, very moody. I particularly like the ones with brown tint, look like sunsets, for instance. I quite like those. I could have done one. Maybe next time we do one like that. Because I quite like it. But this one was quite simple, so I wanted to show it to you and just to explain a bit the principle behind tonalism. So these darks are a touch too dark. I could have lightened it half a step. Maybe I do. I don't remember. It looks like I do, actually. Yeah, I'll go back to the dark. So we'll see. Don't remember. I painted this quite a long time ago. Otherwise, it's a bit too dark. It still fits around the whole picture, but I think I've gone to a 7 there. There should have been, I mean an 8. Should have been more 7 really. Anyway, we all do mistakes. And that's why you need to step back when you do a painting. Because after a while you can't see clearly anymore. You know, everything seems the same color. So you need to have a break, you need to step back, you need to reassess your painting, you need to have a look at it. Oh, here we go, I lighten it a little bit there. That's a bit better. That is much better. There we are. Yeah, that is much better. Still a few darks. But it's not as bad now. Not as bad. Okay, well done me. Because I darkened this, I darkened the trees a little bit as well. Look at those green popping against those purple. Careful not to cover it all up. So don't forget to make me aware of the fact that you liked or disliked that video, so I can learn from my mistakes and try to offer you something that you'd like. But anyway, let me know in the comments if you learned something good. If you haven't, at least I hope you enjoyed watching me painting. This would look good on any wall. For those who like that style, of course. As I mentioned in the previous video, I'm an impressionist. I do some realism, but I don't like it. I did a couple to show on YouTube. I don't enjoy painting them. Result is very nice, but no, it's not my. I much prefer that style, to stay in the impressionistic style. Gives more for the viewer to discover, to imagine. So everything comes together now. See, I darkened a bit that mid-ground, which was a bit light, because I darkened the foreground a bit and the trees again. So I had to darken this as well. So it all fits much better now. Oh, see, don't be shy to use those purples. So I didn't show my palette, but my palette is very simple. I've got ultramarine blue, burnt umber, burnt sienna, yellow ochre, yellow cadmium yellow medium or cadmium yellow lemon. I use I need to think. Oh, in between I have a red, of course, and the red will be an alizarin crimson or quinacridone magenta. And so after the yellow ochre, I will have near the white, I will have a Naples yellow and a titanium white, and that is my palette. And with these colors, I do everything. We talk about it maybe a bit later. or I'll do a special video just with that. So let me know if you want to know about my palette and the mixes that you can achieve with that palette. Leave me a little comment and I'll be glad to do it for you. So that background did a little something, so we added a few trees. So that tutorial is coming to an end. I think we've got 4 minutes left. So what else could I tell you? So I hope the previous one, that you liked the previous video with that woodpecker. It's a bit early to see if you liked it or not. So I only posted it yesterday, so it's a little early, but I hope you like it anyway. And that you do this one too. So the next one will be another maybe short-ish video, and then on the following one we do the sky with the clouds and a bit of sea, but we're mainly going to concentrate on the clouds. Or I've got a nice one of flowers. We'll see. So let's put a few highlights. So these highlights are a mixture that I used for the water and added a little bit more ultramarine blue and alizarin crimson. So when I was living in the UK, I used to get my paints from Jackson's. I'm sure most of you guys know Jackson's. But it's a very good shop. You find everything. The prices are very good. Delivery is very good. Customer service is excellent. No complaints. Much better than here in France. But now we're back in the Dordogne. Nice region. So if you want to visit one day, let me know. You can visit to have a little a course about painting. We could do outdoor painting. So that's it for us. Thank you, and I'll see you soon.